Hi, this is Ben. Currently, there's a suicide watch on Mark Sennett. I haven't been able to find him since Party Marty Squirrel won the BOLA. Oh my God! Thank God, there you are.
You started without me?
I thought you were going to kill yourself that Marty Squirrel won BOLA.
I fucking am. Look, I'm fucking ready.
I was fucking.
Can't do it. Can't tell myself. This spot didn't work.
While Mark tries to kill himself, welcome to Bring On the Bull. I am your host, Ballin' Ben Ledoux. This is your co-host,
Mad Mark Sennett.
Mad-ass Mark Sennett. And we just got back from BOLA BABY!
Tired. Great weekend.
How'd you feel about the main event tonight?
Not who I'd have picked to go over. Not who I'd have picked to beat in the main event. Osprey I'd have picked. Not entirely happy. But I did get to see Chris Hero beat the fuck out of a skinny fuck for like 12 minutes. That I enjoyed.
I thought Chris Hero was going to kill Mark Andrews. However, luckily he didn't, because even though he gave him a pile driver off the middle rope that looked like it broke his neck, he was fine, prim, and proper for his next match a couple minutes later against...
Selling like a champ! Or not.
Against Trevor Lee?
Trevor Lee. God, how did he get to the finals? Delete. Much like this podcast. So, BOLA Baby. We did it.
Great. So let's go through the nights. I mean, so night one. Honestly, night one, there's not a match I did not enjoy. Other than... that ECW throwback match. John Hennigan against reborn Matt Sydal. I like both of them. Yeah. For whatever reason, though, like Mark was saying earlier, it felt like a match you see on Sunday Night Heat.
It really did.
Everybody completely shut out Morrison. Sydal did all right. I enjoyed him. But it just... Maybe it was just because there were so many good matches going on during that night that one had to kind of be a throwaway match to go take a pisky.
And I got him up here, you know, because we've seen so much wrestling over 3 days. I got to try to refresh ourselves on what we saw. So we'll start off with the first one that was on the list. It's not in any order of what happened, but Chris Hero versus
Ain't
Jushin
to fuck with.
Thunder Liger. There we go.
Liger was over as shit.
He really was. Liger was the
Hero,
most
not so much.
Well, Hero's meant to be babyface there, and Liger turned him heel just by turning up. I mean, that match, typical Hero match. He beats the fuck out of somebody. This time it's a legend in Liger. The thing about Hero is, he's like a fucking postman. He always delivers. And, I mean, it wasn't like the greatest match you're ever going to see. Good match. And for Liger, at his age, from many people have seen Liger in the last 4 or 5 years, that was a great Liger match. So I enjoyed it. Right guy went over. Elbow, die. That's what we saw right there.
And one of Tommy N's last matches also against Zack Sabre Jr. Not your typical Zack Sabre Jr. match. End and him went to fucking war. End beat the shit out of him. Sabre beat the shit out of him. Sabre came out on top.
So, again, typical Tommy N match. He kicks the fuck out of people. I mean, fair play to... Zack Sabre Jr., that guy can go in a number of different styles. He can fly. He's obviously a technical wrestler. He can kick the shit out of you, too.
And that night, he kicked the shit out of Tommy End, and it looked amazing.
You put that match on, headline any indie show, everyone go home going, that was a fucking great match. Mm-hmm. Problem you got with Bowler is that just faded
like
into everything else.
Third match of the night.
And it was like, yeah, it's a good match, but, you know, no. It was a great match, but...
And then you had... Phoenix versus Will Ospreay, which currently there's a dude in a fucking ditch somewhere down the street from Rosita for filming part of the finish.
Jackass.
Wasn't us. No, it literally wasn't us. Excalibur's going to be
Excalibur, us. This wasn't us.
It wasn't.
Who wasn't us?
It really wasn't us.
No.
Whoever the guy that did that, it's a dick move for a company like this. I mean, I filmed stuff for my own personal thing, but I didn't at BOLA, which is a surprise to everybody. I literally did not film a single thing of BOLA other than stuff during the intermission before and after the show.
You filmed your dick and sent it to Meltzer. What are you talking about?
No, that was still a picture.
Well, he was there at all three shows, and the disappointment was no super kick to Meltzer, no elbow to Meltzer from fucking Chris Hero.
But Phoenix and Ospreay, I mean, those guys fucking great delivered. Match. I mean, they really did. The things that they did. You know, the big thing that everybody's talking about is the fucking Spanish Fly. They're both landing on their feet and just give each other a fucking stare down. Amazing scene.
That's great.
Mr. Athletic, Jeff Cobb against Ricochet. What the fuck did you say?
What a clash,
I mean,
styles that was.
Such class styles, and those dudes, fucking,
that killed it.
I don't even have words to describe how amazing the match was. Ricochet's a badass. Cobb is a fucking beast, and
Cobb's going places for me. He has a different kind of look. I see that guy will be an NXT guy at some point, no doubt.
Well, and you know, and so the first time we saw him, I was kind of on the fence because we saw him at the King of the Indies in San Jose.
Yeah.
And it was just, you know, oh, guy can, you know, kind of wrestle, cool, whatever. But, you know, that whole weekend was about Timothy Thatcher.
Yeah.
And nobody really cared about Cobb. And now fast forward to now.
Nobody
and, like,
gives a shit about Timothy Thatcher.
Nobody gives a shit about Timothy Thatcher. And Cobb stole the fucking weekend for me. I mean, amazing shit from him all weekend.
Yeah, he was great. And that's what I like about Ricochet. That guy, which is kind of like Sabre Jr., but different. I mean, this guy, for a guy that can fly, is not a small guy. He's not a puny guy. He's well built. He's got every tool that WWE should want. The guy has the most unbelievable balance, can do some great high flying, but he can fucking kick. He also can get out of a submission move pretty fucking sharpish. And you know, he's pretty strong. You know, the guy's got, you know, he went toe to toe with Cobb and did some shit. So again, that match, superb. Now change of fucking pace. The match we're about to discuss.
He's a rhinestone douchebag. I like John Hennigan, John Morrison, Johnny Mundo, whatever the fuck you want to call him.
He's
but better. They didn't have him and Sabu? Seidel.
You're just thinking of drugs. Just because Morrison needs pills to get his cock up is not a fucking problem. It is not related to wrestling. At no point is it cool for someone to say, "Where's your dick pills?" as a chant. What kind of dick would do that at a wrestling show?
I have no idea.
But I wouldn't need dick pills, Melina. I'd fuck you good. Anyway, moving on. That match, for a guy that wanted to be a bowler,
It didn't deliver at all. I mean,
it didn't deliver.
And
I'm leaving that more on
Morrison's
we'll just end than that. The crowd.
You guys will fast forward. It's cool.
much like this podcast in general.
Main event.
What the fuck are you doing? You fast forward to us. Pentagon Jr. versus Mighty Skrull was next on there.
I forgot about that.
Yeah,
Marty
did that to you.
Pentagon and Marty had an amazing match. But, I mean, by this point, you'd seen so many. Actually, no, they were the first match.
Yeah.
Now it's coming back to me because they broke the bottom rope.
They did. They broke the bottom rope.
So night one of BOLA. Show is scheduled to start at 8.
Yep.
They started letting people in at about 8:15.
And it
the show started at 9:30. First match broke the bottom rope.
20-minute intermission followed.
20-minute intermission. Luckily, the way it broke wasn't bad enough to where they had to actually do anything. They just reattached the hooks, tightened it up, and were good to go.
And they had to skin some of it off because the rope then became like half the girth of the other ropes. But,
yeah.
No, it was a decent match. And what was fucking funny was in the match that followed it, the it was another, like, buckle bomb to the bottom or whatever it was.
And it didn't break that time, luckily.
It didn't break that time. No, it didn't. And then the main event was Adam Cole, baby! And the Young Bucks versus Dalton Castle and an interesting selection of boys.
Why did you say it like that?
Because O'Reilly, as a boy, was a little bit too much enjoyment for himself. He loved being a young boy. I'm not sure that Bobby Fish did that much, but yeah, Red Dragon came out, and it was a comedy match, to be fair, the entire way through. Lots of fan up, lots of Meltzer abuse from the Young Bucks.
I think they took a little bit too long to unveil themselves as Red Dragon. I mean, everybody knew it was Red Dragon, but, you know, the Young Bucks were playing up like, oh, you know, they look familiar, but I don't know who they are. And it really took way too long in the match to actually have them be like, oh my god, that's Bobby Fish and Kyle O'Reilly, and really turn into fucking Red Dragon. But it was a comedy match. It was a PWG-style comedy match, so it was decent. And yeah, that was night one. Night two, was the best night.
Hands down.
So,
Sami Callihan versus Cody Rhodes. Now, I had zero expectations going to this. Callihan, for me, has not been in great form since his return to the Indies.
This whole Space Cat gimmick is fucking retarded. I'm sorry, but it's fucking dumb.
It really is dumb. And Cody Rhodes, you're like, not sure, having seen his other couple of indie matches, that it was going to be great.
Him versus Angle was meh, and him versus Sabre was essentially Sabre walking him through an indie match.
And he got a hell of a reaction when he came out.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
And on top of that, he put his working boots on. Double springboard jump to the outside.
Yeah.
The match was incredible. There's nothing much to say. He got his personal ring announcer. He got his shot at Bola.
The star that left them in the dust is what his wife introduced him as.
And from that match, it's 100% true. Like, I was worried he was going to fail on the indies. Honestly, going into night two, I was like, he's already failed on the indies. He should go back. But now, after seeing that, if he puts that work into his other indie matches and doesn't just, you know, kind of blow him off, I think he's going to have big things. So,
I'd agree with that. The next match, well, hard hitting doesn't quite cut it. But
bro.
Matt Riddle, who I'm pretty sure we saw under trees, enjoying the good stuff outside.
Oh, you got to call it wellness. Come on.
He ain't going to do that yet. And listen, UFC's guys don't have to worry about wellness in WWE. That's a well-known fact. They can just waltz in and fucking cut somebody's head open. It's fine. He'll be main eventing SummerSlam next year. yeah, he was up against Kyle O'Reilly. I didn't really like the finish to the match, but the match
was the finish physical. Made sense.
It did make sense, as they wanted to put O'Reilly over. Talk him through the finish.
Yeah, well, so let's just go through the whole match. I mean, this was the one match I was looking forward to the entire weekend. And surprisingly, it's actually not even in my top five best matches, even though I feared this would be the one match I care about more than anything. These guys went in and were beating the shit out of each other. I mean, you know, Matt Riddle's a bona fide MMA star. Kyle O'Reilly is, you know, the play one on TV, but is convincing enough to make you believe he's an MMA star. The horsewomen that were there were popping at the fucking exchanges. These guys went hold for hold, everything else. So the way it ended was Seidel locked, or no, Seidel, what? Riddle.
What are you session with Seidel?
I'm out of it. Actually, it was Sabu.
So, but Seidel was out of it night one.
Riddle was...
really out of it permanently in the main of night two. We'll come to that.
Riddle put him in the bro mission, and he had him locked in. You thought Riddle was going to take the match. O'Reilly turned it into a pin, 1-2-3. It counters on Riddle being a little, you know, green, you know, to everything. It's kind of like the Brett versus Austin Survivor Series 96 finish.
It just felt like quite a slow count as well.
I mean, yes and no, but at least it was a way to have Riddle look like he's going to win the match, but, you know, the more experienced professional wrestler gets the pin on him, but it's not really to say that he got beat. He got the pin, but it was his own stupidity, essentially, that led it to happen. So I thought it made sense if you're going to bring Riddle back. If you're not, you should have just, you know, had somebody beat him clean, whatever. But he was one of the most over guys of the weekend.
He was.
So to have it do that and then hopefully bring him back, I mean, I think that's the way to go.
Now, the next match, Cedric Alexander, fresh off of a plane from King of Trios, where he lost a night one over there, has to cross the country to come up against my fellow countryman and lives in the same county as me, Oxfordshire, Mark Haskins.
Meh.
Yeah, it was kind of meh, actually. But you watched it alone, decent match, but it didn't set the world on fire. It wasn't like Ibushi Alexander, that's for sure.
It's true.
It It didn't have that many high spots in it. The problem that Haskins had for me all weekend was he wasn't particularly stiff with anything that he did in terms of chops or kicks, and a couple were sloppy. Not being nitpicky, but it was. And yeah, just kind of, you can't get them all right. And that one didn't really do it for me. I don't think the right guy went over. Haskins went over.
It was a good match. I mean, I guess the thing that people need to realize is that what we're comparing these matches to are, some of the best matches I've ever seen. I mean, I want to say that probably four of the best matches I've ever seen have happened in the last three nights. I mean, so it was a decent match. It would have been something fine on any PWG card. So.
And Kamatachi Trevor Lee. Well, Trevor Lee was the surprise push of the weekend. He was booed throughout for being a TNA guy.
And Kamatachi did a top rope senton to the fucking floor. Where I'm pretty sure he got concussed enough to where he couldn't find his way to night three, because we saw him wandering around Rosita looking for a subway. So
he's now been taken captive by the laundrette owner down the road. He's got it working.
If somebody in Rosita runs into Kamatachi, please help him find his way home.
Tell him I said hi.
Konnichiwa.
He was great. Kamatachi was great. Trevor Lee.
I like Trevor Lee's decent, but I don't know. Maybe his TNA commitments have kind of pulled him away from the indie so much that I just kind of forget him out of it at this point. I mean, and I don't watch TNA, so.
Who the fuck does?
Any of you? Yeah, we didn't think so.
No. And, next up, Mandrews versus Pete Dunne. Now, this was a surprise, a pleasant surprise for Pete Dunne. Welcome to fucking PWG, America, whatever else, because Pete Dunne looked fucking good.
So I saw a Rev Pro match with Pete Dunne, and I was like, it was all right. I mean, whatever. That dude came to Rosita to fucking work. The fact that he didn't go over and get Hero in the second round, made me almost fucking cry.
And funny enough, that's who he would have got, because that's who Mandrews got. Which
exactly, yeah.
To.
And yeah, I mean, I don't know. Mandrews is all right, but whatever.
No, I mean, I thought Pete Dunne was great. I mean, if you could see him in a hard-hitting match with Chris Hero, you'd all fucking love that. That shit needs to happen somewhere. I probably got a chance to have it at Rev Pro at some point, because Hero's starting to work Rev Pro again.
I mean, hell, maybe it's already happened. We should eventually look it up.
We don't look shit up. We just get you guys to shout at us.
Yeah, somebody tell me I'm an idiot. Send me the link.
You're an idiot. Send them the link. Anyway, next up, Dalton Castle with the Real Boys. And, not Jack Gallagher. Jack Gallagher jobbed to British Airways. British Airways did not deliver Jack Gallagher.
Hey, Jack Gallagher, fly me out to a show to see you, because you were actually the other reason I went to BOLA, and you're not fucking there, so.
Was I the first? No, Fat Chicks the
Riddle,
second.
Riddle, I mean, Kyle O'Reilly was first.
Okay, where do I fit on the list?
Aren't you the Fat Chick?
God, I hope not. I wonder why I was sore this morning. That was all the walking I was doing. Or the Hindu squats.
So yeah, so Gallagher was gone.
Deeper. Lower.
We got Tommaso Ciampa as a surprise, which was cool. I mean,
it
wasn't
intro.
Jack Gallagher, but he's got a fucking amazing intro.
He really does. He had an amazing intro. He's not going to have that in WWE. I mean,
we'll always have memories.
And we will always have memories of the Psycho Killer. And the Psycho Killer got his teeth kicked out of his mouth for the trouble of turning up to Pro Wrestling Guerrilla. But what I will say, again, it was pretty hard hitting again.
Yeah, decently good match.
He could have just turned up and done nothing. And it would have been understandable he was a last-minute replacement. But they had a great near-fall at the start where it looked like it looked like that Ciampa was going to get rolled up quick, wasn't
it? Yes, yes.
And everyone's like, oh, God, he's not allowed to work. No, they then went on to have a
really good match. Dalton went over. It was good. Dalton was my my dark horse pick to win the weekend. With obviously my first pick being, so it was either, to me, it was Marty Dalton Castle or Ospreay. I mean, I think that's who everybody had.
So. I thought Ospreay all weekend. Mm-hmm. I really did. So, didn't happen. Now, next,
we had the first half main events.
One of the greatest matches I have ever seen live. It's just truly phenomenal.
Heroes Eventually Die, consisting of Chris Hero, Tommy Ends, against Phoenix and Pentagon Jr. Oh, fuck.
That had fucking flips, sentons, elbows, kicks, everything you want. You see guy flying through the air, met with a fucking forearm to the face.
But it started out with some fucking asshole sitting in the crowd talking shit to Hero. Hero getting out, going towards him, and they'd be like, he ain't worth it. When Tommy End walks over next to it, and is like, well, fuck this guy. And Hero's like, no, let's go ahead and head back to the ring. And Tommy End's like, I'm not fucking having that. I'm going to beat the fuck out of this dude. He's a fucking asshole. To which I started chanting, Tommy's going to kill you, and got the entire crowd to chant it. And some dude stood there and pissed his pants like, I'm not scared. Tommy End would have killed that motherfucker. And we all would have fucking covered for him and helped him bury the body.
You said something really interesting there.
Hmm?
The dude nearly pissed his pants. So,
anyways, we're going to go ahead and talk about the first half main event. We were talking about the first half main event. It was an amazing match. I mean, everybody was saying the first half main event and the other half main event, which was the best match, and, you know, which one was a five-star match. I mean, both of them, honestly, were phenomenal matches. The near falls, the high spots, everything else. This tag team match is going to go on to be one of the greatest tag team matches probably in PWG history. I mean, it was amazing.
I mean, you know, the finish was Hero having a sleep outside while...
And eating the pin since he's leaving, yeah, obviously.
To be fair to poor old Tommy End, he eats the pin in fucking every tag match those guys have.
That's true.
If he ever is working with Hero, he ends up eating the pin if they get a job. So, I mean, that match, the thing you understand about it, again, I know it sounds like we love Hero because we do love Hero. He and Tommy End can really sniff the fuck out of people. You forget that it's a goddamn work when those two guys are working. And so again, another contrast in styles of, you know, Phoenix and Pentagon, and and they had the spot of the weekend.
But, you know, it,
they had
the spot also of the weekend, wasn't.
Didn't they? In there when Pentagon put Phoenix on his shoulder and
did the moonsault.
Did the moonsault off straight the outside onto End.
And but, you know, it wasn't so much a clash styles. I mean, they beat the shit out of each other. They both threw kicks. They threw some punches, kicks. Some elbows, whatever. But yeah, and then you have the second half main event, which was the Young Bucks and Adam Cole against Ricochet, Ospreay, and Sydal.
Sydal almost died.
We're pretty sure that Ricochet decided he wanted to be the only high flyer of the team and tried paralyzing his partner. Ricochet, what the fuck? I know we saw you giggling underneath some trees the day before, but you nearly killed your partner. That motherfucker took a dive off the top rope while you were supposed to be holding him, and you forgot about it. But other than that, an amazing match. Again, you know, the near falls, the moves, all the fucking high spots. They did the triple upside down flip, landed there and did the pose. They finished the match with the stereo shooting star presses to beat the Young Bucks and Adam Cole.
Hang on. Before the stereo shooting star presses.
Oh, the Young Bucks kissed each other.
We will come back to that, but which I know is going to get you hard for a while.
Cranksky!
You're missing the improved Meltzer driver that Sydal and Ricochet gave to one of the fucking Bucks. He did a shooting star press
fucking spike pile driver. It was amazing.
It was amazing.
The Young Bucks, ever to be one-upped, improved on that the night after, which we'll talk about on night three.
He never won up a young buck. And, yeah, I mean, that the crowd was shouting, five-star match, and they were jawing with Meltzer whether it was going to be. And
Meltzer, you know, did his, like, you know, grin, whatever.
She had a little grin.
And then Ricochet brought it up on the microphone. Osprey gave him a fucking point right
Osprey
at him.
Osprey gave him a fucking... I don't remember that.
He was about to get that 5 stars.
They brought him out of the house, Johnson, and gave him a fucking... I wanted to do was crying last night.
But, no, amazing main event. And like I said, I mean, you know, the amount of just amazing match year candidates they put on these three nights. These guys were working their ass off. It was insane. And we haven't got to night three yet.
Nope.
So night three, let's start off.
Well, this is where we've run out of the fucking card.
Yeah, we're calling on the fly right now. But
let's talk about the ones that we can't remember straight off the bat.
Ricochet versus John Morrison, Hennigan, Mundo,
Dick Pilnader,
Batista.
Yeah, this one, Hennigan really needed to come out and do something. Because the guy's always wanted to work BOLA. I was questioning it after his night before performance. He turned up tonight. He had a decent match with Ricochet.
They did a fucking parkour lesson for the ages. But a good one. It fit with the match they're trying to put on. They did a bunch of good spots. Everybody was into it. It was good.
Henning could never hit his finish. And again, what did I say?
Henning.
He worked?
Not recently.
didn't he win the Rumble? No, that's his kid.
Yeah.
Yeah. But either way, the guy that wasn't in three-man band got pinned. And it was, again, it was decent. I mean, Morrison got met at the end with a Please Come Back challenge, which I'm sure he will really appreciate.
Yeah, I mean, Morrison, I think he did a great job on night three.
I'm sure that will mean the world to him after you've reminded everybody that he needs dick pills throughout this podcast.
He said it like 8 times.
He can't go 8 times. That's why he's got the pills. He also can't.
Next, we have.
He can't go 3 times in one night either. That's why he did with BOLA.
Put a Haskins face.
Let's just go to, before we get there, the match that I enjoyed.
Chris Hero against Mark Andrews.
The greatest thing
I'm
going to
let
ever...
him take over real quick while I get water.
The greatest thing I have ever witnessed in wrestling was the first, like, 30 seconds of this match. They introduce Mark Andrews, and before they can announce Hero, he just fucking charges across the ring like a fucking buffalo and kicks him square in the fucking jaw. And then he just does not stop kicking and elbowing. It was 12 minutes of the absolute most glorious Q Bobby Root fucking shit I've ever seen. Basically, Andrews was kicked high up in here. He was kicked everywhere. He didn't get a fucking offensive move in for about the first 6 minutes. But again, typical fucking Hero takes a reverse Hurricane Rana, which is just fucking ridiculous from Andrews. And, you know, we all thought the Hero was going to go through, but I think it was a quick inside cradle, wasn't it? So a surprise inside cradle.
And
that
shocked
was
the world.
Shock of a bowler. Everyone goes, fuck me.
The greatest thing about that was Excalibur actually hopped up and started freaking out, almost like that wasn't what was supposed to happen. So, I mean, good on Excalibur, who's sitting in the back of trying to, you know, have some little detail of like, oh, fuck, that, you know, that went against what we were trying to do. So, that was cool. And then...
Then the post finish. Hero's just fucking stood there in shock. And Mandrews is like, oh, I fucking won. Well, fuck me. Elbowed him to fucking death from across the ring. Fucking annihilated him. And then did one of the sweetest moves I've ever seen. Picks him up, middle rope, and does fucking pretty much a cradle pile driver. Straight, well, like a spike pile driver, really. That straight from the middle rope. And God, it looked like he fucking killed him. But this is probably my biggest complaint from that. Mandrew should have been fucking selling that throughout. He should have been helped to the back, but he got up about, you know, 90 seconds later, just kind of like, a little bit. And by the time that he comes out for his next round match, literally just touches his neck a couple of times and then just does the flips and the flops and whatever else.
Who beat Sabre?
Who beat Sabre? God damn it, why can't I remember who beat Osprey? Osprey beat Sabre. Ospreay versus Sabre.
There we go.
And that was a good match as well. You know, it's two friends going at it. I know a lot of people have seen that match before.
Oh, yeah, Sabre was beating the shit out of Ospreay. That's right.
Sabre was beating the shit out of Ospreay. And Ospreay had a great weekend. Okay, he was tremendous throughout. It didn't go on particularly long, that one. That was probably about 15 minutes, but it was enough. Probably my only complaint about Zack Sabre Jr. is kind of the same what I'm going to go with him, Andrews, is he just doesn't really sell being kicked in the fucking face or someone just, you know, doing a high-impact move. I mean, he's got all the talent in the world, but, yeah, he didn't really sell shit during that. Although, I do really enjoy Will Ospreay's one where he catches the guy upside down,
motherfucker,
and kicks him square in the fucking face in the corner.
Oh, yeah, that too. That's nice.
So Cody Rhodes worked night three of BOLA. He was up against... You can't fucking remember, can you?
He's a villain.
Yeah, I
know. Marty Scurll against Cody Rhodes. It was amazing. Actually, I saw another chant during that. When Marty Scurll set up Cody Rhodes for the Shattered Dreams, and Brandi Rhodes is on the outside going, "What the fuck?" And I was like, "She wants kids! She wants kids!" Whole sort of thing started going.
Like, "Yes, I do!"
Well, I think Cody Rhodes is sitting there like, "Hurry up and do it. She'll call me later from the booking office."
Kick me in the dick! Kick me in the dick!
Cody once again came out, had a great match with the...
Fuck, I thought that was his brother. Jesus.
Had a great match with Marty Scurll. Scurll went over.
Yeah, but there was another quite nice spot in that match where...
Scurll made out with his wife.
Yeah, that's exactly where I was going with that. So Scurll goes to the outside and is like, "Yeah, kiss me on the cheek. Kiss me on the cheek." And she's like, "No, you kiss me on the cheek." Because she's obviously a nice flirt. And so...
She's only married.
So they both she leans in to kiss him on the cheek. God knows why she's about to adulterate her husband.
She slapped him in the face. I figured she slapped him in the face, but for whatever reason, she's going to give him a kiss.
And he moves.
While her boyfriend's holding his dick. It's the weirdest fucking threesome I ever saw in public. Is that the only three?
That is.
Anyways.
That is pretty much what revived Cody's penis, because he's like shocked the other side of the fucking ropes.
Didn't even need
that
more.
She's got
dick
pills
business
for herself.
Marty goes over, great match. Everybody wants to see Rhodes back too. I thought he did great.
I think he was really good.
As long as he keeps that enthusiasm going and doesn't just start phoning in shit like, you know, a lot of people do. I think he can really make this, but he needs to not have the match he had in Evolve and have the matches that he had in PWG. So
Trevor Lee.
Who gives a fuck about him? Let's move on
Trevor,
to... No, fuck that. No. We're moving on to the Young Bucks against...
We're going to Dalton Castle.
Let's move on to the Young Bucks against Phoenix and Pentagon Jr. One of the other great fucking matches.
Amazing match.
Okay. So people who know a lot about Lucha Libre history, when a match is exceptionally great, people throw money into the ring.
I do that to women a lot. I do the Divas matches. Hey, Sasha, you the boss.
Yeah.
She's right.
She'll... 10 years, she'll throw your underwear.
Yes.
For a couple bucks.
Yes.
So they did that during this match. That's how good this match was. And it was probably also PWG wanted to be, you know, "Oh, this is Mexican wrestling culture. Let's do it." Whatever. Who knows what it is. But bottom line is, an amazing fucking match. People are throwing money at them at the end of the match.
And a scene that Repo Man would be proud of. The Bucks come out, super kick him in the face,
and take all
steal
the money.
You know,
that's a worker.
If Meltzer had known that the fucking Bucks didn't get the money, he'd have tossed the fucking fifth key in there straight away.
But it's an amazing match, and once again, I mean, the way that they're setting up these false finishes and everything is it's just ridiculous. And the
Jim Cornette turned over in his grave.
Jim Cornette did a flip in his grave. Rosie did a flip, got pissed off, started working the left side.
The good news is when we get to the Liger match later on, Jim Ross and Cornette would have enjoyed them slowing the pace down. We'll come to that.
But, you know, the false finishes, people legitimately thought that there was a chance that Pentagon Jr. and Phoenix were going to become the new PWG Tag Team Champions, which I think a lot of people are hoping for. I mean,
Pentagon, it's
not a PWG...
On the outside, didn't he?
Oh, yeah. But it's not a PWG tag division anymore. It's the Young Bucks. they're holding the belts
they
and
take on all cups.
Every now and then some people show up to, you know, for whatever, but I mean, that's all it is.
I mean, there was a number of great spots. Pentagon had his finish on the apron of the ring, and then did it again in the middle, I think, on Nick Jackson. That we were sure that was going to be a three. And then, you know, probably second spot of the entire weekend was, fuck me, the Meltzer driver on the outside. Flying over the ropes. Fucking spike tombstone pile driver from inside
on the floor.
On the floor, fucking amazing. Go inside, do another Meltzer driver. Fucking, I think it was Phoenix kicks out. And
No. Phoenix pulled the ref out.
Yeah, that's
which,
right.
Which is why we're like, okay, pull the ref out. Pentagon and Phoenix have to go over. Didn't end up happening. They gave him 46 super kicks.
Oh no, the finish was 20 super kicks. I mean, that's
per Young Buck, so 40.
So they start super kicking him a couple of times, and like they just like fucking wobbling, and then go down to both to their knees, like pretty much like Sonny and Mizzy Hyatt, and you know, but they then Pentagon and Phoenix spit at the Young Bucks, and at which point they give them 10.
They went
super
into fucking hyper,
each, and that was the fucking finish, and it was glorious. It was fucking amazing. And so
there were some other matches. Let's just go ahead and talk about the ones that, you know, really matter. We got to see Ricochet Osprey again.
Ricochet Osprey. Really good match.
Really good. It wasn't as good as the Dallas one.
I mean, it couldn't have been as good as the Japan one either.
It wasn't really as good as the Japan one, but it was still really good, and they started it off in fourth gear. I mean, they just one after another, just ridiculous.
I thought Ricochet had a great weekend.
Oh yeah, an amazing weekend. And so Osprey went over. That leads us to the finals. But we'll get to that in a second. Now we have to talk about 10, 10, 10, 10, and not that 10. You know what 10?
Joanne Rose?
No, the 10-man tag.
Oh, Thumsky.
Oh.
Yeah, Chucky T worked.
So let's talk about who was in this 10-man tag. So on one side,
Team Psycho Killer Cat, whatever it was.
Psycho Killer Cat fucking whatever.
So Ciampa. It was Bro.
Callahan.
Fucking Space Cadet. The Shock of the Night. The Brian Kendrick.
Brian Kendrick.
Who looked like Adam Rose. Shockingly.
On meth. And the fifth person.
Oh, done. Be done.
The Bruiserweight. And they all dressed like cats. Or had the face paint of cats.
And like, yeah, fucking
It was weird. But whatever.
It was really weird.
And then on the other side,
Team Liger.
Team Liger.
Liger over shit.
Jeff Cobb.
Jushin Thunder Liger.
Chucky T.
You could forget.
Tommy fucking in.
Ciampa. Nope, he was on the other side. He wasn't on both sides.
Cedric Alexander.
They're alike.
They're both signed with WWE.
Exactly. Now, this match ended up being a comedy match. It's led.
No, but it wasn't. So yeah, I mean, Chucky T did the don't stick your thumb up my butt thing to Ciampa, because Ciampa fucking does it every single time. But in the middle of all this, you know, comedy and all this other bullshit, because you did have Brian Kendrick yelling at Cedric Alexander saying, if you fucking slap the leg one more time, you give me a kick, I'm going to whoop your ass. You're better than that. There's some good comedy in there. But in the middle of it all, you had the fucking Bro, Matthew Riddle, and Jeff Cobb putting on a fucking clinic. You have a fucking Olympic wrestler and a former UFC guy fucking grappling like crazy. It was amazing. I mean, it was something that stuck out in that match.
Not as much as something that stuck in the match.
It
turns out that Liger liked it in the ass. Who knew? It took fucking 20
Chucky
years.
Chucky T was all almost about to get the finger in the or the thumb in the butt when Liger jumped in and said he wanted the thumb in the butt.
And that started
crazy
the Japanese chain
people.
Reaction.
I'm kind of scared to go to Tokyo in case we're on a subway and I get a thumb in my butt.
Well, you know what?
Maybe that's how they hold on when the fucking bullet train's moving.
It turned into one giant fucking conga line. where all 10 men have their thumb up the other one's butt, and fucking Liger starts leading a conga.
Choo choo! They're gonna put a strongman gimmick on him in fucking the Continental.
And then he manages to wiggle his hips, and they all fucking flop the other nine. It's a bump onto the floor. The weirdest shit I've seen. They didn't get up.
And they had a slow motion spot where we're all fucking slow motion. Whatever. It was all right.
You were really into it. I mean, you literally started whacking it slower and slower
and deeper and slower and deeper and
And in the end, Liger hit play, and it was a Juicy Liger chant. And in the end, Liger went over for the first time in 15 years. Liger won a
multi-man match. That wasn't on the first half of the card. So you move on to the finals. He hated the fact that Marty Scurll won.
I hate the fact that Trevor Lee was in the final, too. I mean, I
didn't care for Trevor Lee.
I found it strange.
What annoyed me was Trevor Lee, to me, honestly kind of seemed like the afterthought of the tournament. So I don't understand why.
That was Jack Gallagher.
Jack Gallagher, you owe me a fucking match. I mean, just fly me out. Whatever. Whatever.
You trust him with travel arrangements? Fuck.
Actually, man. I don't. Just reimburse me when I get there.
You want a refund for BOLA? Fuck.
No, not a refund for BOLA. A refund for not getting to see fucking Gallagher.
Okay.
If you get signed, give me tickets to a Raw so I can fucking watch you work in person.
So you need to fucking turn up first. So, yeah, I mean, I thought it was strange.
Trevor Lee was the afterthought. He should have went out first, and they should have had Ospreay and Scurll, because I mean that's Sabre's next two challengers.
That he was, I thought it straight up, it was strange that Trevor Lee made it all the way to the final. Yeah. To be honest, I can see why Marty got there in terms of what they want to do. They need a heel to face Sabre, etc. They got history, the best friends.
Well, and Ospreay beat Sabre, so he's gonna end up getting a PWG shot too.
Yeah, and of course the way that the match was booked out was
smart booking.
What are you bringing Jim Barnett up for?
Cornette.
Who'd he beat? You're struggling. You never won a match in his life. I thought it was strange on two fronts. To have the three in the main event that was there, Ospreay, Trevor Lee, a shock to be there, and Party Marty. What to me was disappointing was Ospreay was, you know, getting some good cheers from the crowd. The crowd were digging him being there. That people thought it was probably going to be Marty or it could be Ospreay. But basically, they locked him in the chicken wing and Trevor Lee just kept kicking the fuck out of him while he was on the floor. And the crowd kind of felt down when Ospreay went out because no one cared about Trevor Lee, with all due respect, and just assumed that Marty was going to win. I think if he got it down to Marty versus the villain, there'd have been real question of who's going to win this. There was no question of who was going to win.
For the regulars, they could probably see Trevor Lee having a shot. I mean, you know, I want to say, you know, 2 years ago, I was probably one of the people saying, oh, Trevor Lee deserves a shot and he should win BOLA from the BOLA I was watching at that point. But at this point, you know, and maybe I just don't watch as much PWG. I mean, I've seen most of their shows in the last year. But yeah, Trevor Lee feels like an afterthought to me. I mean, he's a TNA guy now. That's how I see him. So, you know, him.
Think that's his final deletion?
Maybe. I mean, I was surprised Andrew Everett wasn't in here, but once again, like, I see him as a TNA guy, you know, now. I don't see him a lot. You know, Trevor Lee, he was working Evolve for a while until that, you know, he disappeared from there. You know, yeah, to me, he was an afterthought. But bottom line is, Marty Scurll is your 2016 Battle of Los Angeles champion.
I enjoyed it. So many spots and so many matches over the years in the UK.
But
much improved. He's much. I just don't think. I think he spent far too much of his match with Mark Haskins in the semi final just fucking trying to get cheap heel heat from the crowd. But
which I didn't mind because I didn't.
Because you were bored of the match. That's why.
I'm sorry. Haskins, you're doing better, but I still think of you as the guy that showed up to TNA to wrestle Doug Williams and fucking. Failed. Sorry.
Which was the same.
You're growing on me, just not very much right now.
As well, he didn't even win the fucking thing. Spud did. But, so I guess.
Potato?
Right.
I should have fucked a potato now.
Fuck. That's Chris Hero's job. He likes potatoes because he thinks they're food. But great three nights of wrestling. Probably, without doubt, the best three nights of wrestling I ever watched.
So, MVP of the weekend.
That's a tough one. I'm going to go with Ricochet. I thought Ricochet was great in every match that he had.
He almost killed his partner.
He did nearly kill his partner, which may have been doing fucking Rob Naylor a favor. He's with Seidel. Yeah, I mean, Chris Hero deserves a lot of fucking praise for the work that he put into, as do the guys in the Lucha Underground, of course, the Bucks. But I'm going to go with Ricochet simply because I thought he had great matches. It was a brilliant six-man tag. We just haven't gone up for superlatives for. I thought he had a really good match with John Morrison, which I think that was going to be a struggle to a degree with that audience and the way that Morrison works. He's not, but they pulled it out of the bag. Big time. The Ospreay match was fucking great. Not superb, but fucking great. So for me, I think Ricochet, that guy is ready for big, big things now. That guy, he needs to be signed now. And then honorable mention to Chris Hero, because yet again, his streak, I must have seen that guy work live in the last 2 years 15 times. I have not failed to be entertained in any of those matches against an array of guys. Chris Hero, for me,
ain't nothing to fuck with.
He's definitely ain't nothing to fuck with, and it's the biggest shame in wrestling that that guy isn't earning millions of dollars at the top of WWE. He could kick the fuck out of Lesnar or whatever he wanted to be believable.
He'd be a great challenger to Lesnar.
And it's a fucking tragedy that he spent as much time at the buffet table as I do. So, your MVP?
I think that Phoenix stepped out of the shadows of his brother this weekend. He was in three matches that easily over 4 stars. He had Ospreay the first night that they just fucking killed it. A lot of people say it was, the aura of Ospreay and everything along with that, but those guys went out, did work. Then you had the next night against him and like I said, his brother, might have helped him a little bit, but I feel like he stepped out of the shadow of Pentagon and Phoenix against Heroes Eventually Die. Insane match, just killing it. And third night against the Young Bucks. I mean, like I said, people were throwing money in the ring. It was a weekend. Phoenix really stepped up and put in his work. Ricochet had an amazing weekend too.
Ospreay had a great weekend.
Ospreay had a great weekend too. I mean, there's no way to really pick one MVP
because you're a pussy.
But I'm picking Phoenix, but everybody else was right there too. I mean, everybody had a good weekend other than Matt Seidel nearly dying and John Morrison shitting his pants in the first night.
And match of the weekend. That's hard. That is fucking hard.
It's harder than John Morrison on dick pills.
Well, I'm going to have to give it to the most fuck me moments definitely goes to the six-man tag with the Young Bucks against Ospreay, Ricochet, and Seidel. But I'm actually going to say that's the greatest tag match I've ever seen with Hero and End versus the Mexicals. Especially the lawnmower spot when it came in. I thought that was the best tag match I've ever seen. And that's my match of the weekend. You?
That's mine too. That's what everybody was debating about. We even asked Meltzer about which one do you think was better, the tag team match or the main event 16-6 man tag match.
You say six person because you think the fucking Bucks are girls, don't you? And you thought
they did kiss each other.
He was like, "Hot lesbian action!" We're kissing. Yeah, no. That's what we're saying. He
was grabbing himself during it. But he was like, that one's too tough to call. So that tells you just how great the matches were.
Line of the weekend. You know what it is.
The line of the weekend was something about one of the Young Bucks deciding he wanted to go ahead and finish off Magnum and Tully. which wouldn't be too hard with Magnum.
He fucking screams to Ricochet, "I would kill you and your whole family." And like a Porsche, he nearly did. It was fucking a great line. The Young Bucks are great value anytime that they talk shit. I mean, they're screaming, do something athletic, and then do like 15 flips and just do an eye poke. It was, if you've not seen the Young Bucks live, you need to go out and enjoy them now, because the second they eventually get into WWE, which I think they will, they'll have to change their style in terms of what they do. They can't do 101 super kicks. They can't put themselves over throughout the entire match like they do. You should go and enjoy them now. You should go out and enjoy Chris Hero, because that guy is doing some amazing shit. You should enjoy Ricochet and Ospreay before he paralyzes himself. And Sydal's while I do that first. Because this is a period in wrestling, for me, independent wrestling, which is just fucking glorious era of guys that love professional wrestling.
Like Marty Squirrel. Your BOLA champion.
BOLA baby! But what I will say is, you should go out and if you want to go to PWG, you should go. I mean, I flew 11 and a half hours to do it. Great decision. And it's such a mixed bag, from thumb up the butt from Jushin Liger to Chris Hero kicking a man's face off into the front row.
You're trying to fight your way through a crowd to buy merch.
That's fucking scary. And some of the chicks there are pretty scary as well. And
how did Jessamyn Duke's butt feel, by the way?
Yeah, that... He kind of fucked me over on that one. So we're walking past her. He fucking stops and knocks my arm straight into her ass. It is like proper cup ejection on the ass. I'm like a fucking octopus sucked onto that thing. I'm like, oh shit. She looks around and kind of looks at me. I'm like, hey, how you doing? I'm like fucking pissing myself and just walk away before she breaks me. I mean, that guy didn't touch the other one, who's clearly a lesbian, that would have just broken me. But, yeah, I mean, how did her ass feel? Pretty fucking sweet. Too sweet, one should say, buddy. No? Hear me hanging? Well, I enjoyed it.
Impending rape charges right here.
So a wonderful, wonderful weekend of wrestling.
Another pro tip. If you're going to go to the shows, get GA. Go to the last row of seats, and there's actually some...
big pictures on
the
wall.
Big pictures back there. Push your seats a little bit back so people don't want to get between your seats and the pictures. And then you can fucking stand the entire time in the back row. It's fucking amazing.
So basically, all you're going to see in BOLA this week is this fucking crotch. I'm selling. I'm better than fucking Saber. I'm selling.
And with that, bring on the shovel. BOLA road trip.
It's been fucking amazing.